Good afternoon, Dr. Freer.
Good afternoon, and I'm ready to go.
Give me one second. Okay, when you're ready, Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining the Los Angeles County Department of Public Health today, December 2nd, for our media briefing. Today, we have the Director of Public Health, Dr. Barbara Freer, presenting. Dr. Freer will then take your questions. Remember to ask a question, please use the hand icon, or you may chat me, the host. Dr. Freer, when you are ready.
Yeah, thank you. And thank you, everyone, for joining me for today's briefing. This afternoon, I'll provide information on Omicron, present our metrics by vaccination status and age groups, our progress getting residents vaccinated, and information as well on the success we've had at some of our schools. I do want to note that since schools weren't in session last week, we'll provide updates on school cases and outbreaks next week. And I'll take the first slide. Throughout the pandemic, we've always known that there would be more mutations, resulting in the possibility of a more dangerous variant than the Delta variant. And we're prepared, as is the rest of our country, to respond to the emerging science. This past week, we have been tracking the emergence and spread of Omicron, labeled a variant of concern by both the WHO and the CDC. Yesterday, the first case was announced in the United States in a traveler returning from South Africa. This morning, a second case was identified in a person in Minnesota with recent travel to New York. And just now, a third case was identified in Colorado. We anticipate hearing about new cases here in our country, as well as in other countries, on an ongoing basis moving forward. The new variant, which was labeled B.1.1.529, was first identified in South Africa on November 9th with a high number of mutations, creating concerns related to immune evasion and transmissibility. This new variant was designated a variant of concern by the World Health Organization last Friday, November 26th, and named Omicron. On November 30th, CDC also declared Omicron a variant of concern. What makes Omicron worrisome is that it has a very unusual constellation of mutations. Early analysis shows that there are 50 changes and deletions, more than 30 of which are on the spike gene. This mutation profile is clearly very different from other circulating variants of concern and variants of interest, and it does not appear to be derived from Delta or other variants of concern. Of note, some of the mutations to the spike gene could affect the structure enough to increase infectivity, evade immunity, and impact response to certain therapeutics. Early signs from diagnostic laboratories indicates that Omicron spreads rapidly, as it is now the dominant strain in South Africa, and it's likely to be present in most provinces in South Africa. And as I noted, as of today or this morning, Omicron was present in 35 countries with 3 cases in the United States. There are currently no cases that we know of in LA County, but since we receive sequenced specimens every single day, and the same is happening all across the country, we think these numbers are likely to increase across the country, and we're likely to detect our first case here in the county in a matter of days. Next slide. I do want to emphasize that while we're still learning a lot about transmissibility, the severity of cases, the risk of infection, and vaccine effectiveness, there are steps we're taking to prepare our county, starting with providing residents and our partners with updated information about Omicron and precautionary safety measures. Earlier this week, LA County healthcare providers received an advisory from the Department of Public Health detailing information on assessing risk and directions for submitting samples for sequencing. Residents can also get daily updates on Omicron by clicking on the banner on our homepage. Our lab is also coordinating with the state lab for the identification of Omicron with specimen testing. Currently, anywhere between 1,500 and 5,000 positive specimens from LA County residents are sequenced each week, with results reported to both LA County and to the state. And we're going to continue to rely on the network we have of commercial and public health labs to ensure that we're receiving a representative assessment of the prevalent variants in LA County. And of course, we'll continue to share this information with you and with the public. Again, to date, the county lab and our private commercial partners have not identified any presence of Omicron in any sequence specimens from LA County residents. With 1.7 million students and staff back at schools this week after the Thanksgiving break, we're also working with all school districts to reinforce the importance of existing school-based public health requirements and their routine testing programs. We also have teams that are realigning plans for protecting those who are most vulnerable, including those who live and work at skilled nursing facilities, our jails, and our shelters. This includes ensuring adequate supplies of testing kits and PPE, along with modifying policies to ensure optimal safety as warranted. Later this week, we'll be modifying our instructions at our skilled nursing facilities and working with skilled nursing facilities to introduce more routine testing of residents and staff and to offer rapid testing for visitors that are entering any indoor spaces at these facilities. And in partnership with LAX, the state, and with the Centers for Disease Control, we'll be standing up a rapid testing site at the International Terminal tomorrow that'll be able to provide information and offer rapid testing to international travelers. We'll be messaging the need for international travelers to comply with the federal quarantine and testing guidance. And any travelers that do test positive will be required, of course, to isolate, and their close contacts will need to quarantine. Next slide. I, like I know so many of you, am concerned about the implications of a more infectious variant on the safety of coworkers, friends, and family, and what this could mean for our recovery journey. And while we can't know for certain the impact of Omicron, I am heartened by the fact that we have a lot of experience slowing the spread of COVID, along with many effective tools that we know work to reduce transmission. The most effective tool remains vaccines, and we do encourage everyone, 5 and older, not yet vaccinated or boosted, to do so with a sense of urgency. The vaccines, which were developed over a year ago, have proven to be effective against the Delta variant as well as earlier strains of the virus. And this is what gives us reasonable hope that these same vaccines will provide some protection against Omicron. As a reminder, residents can walk into any public health vaccination site or make appointments at hundreds of sites across the county to get vaccinated. And as always, for more information, please visit vaccinatelacounty.com. While teams are working to determine how effective the vaccines are against Omicron, all residents across LA County should continue adhering to the masking requirements and always wear a mask when indoors or at large outdoor mega events, regardless of your vaccination status. We know have been also strongly recommending that you wear a mask when you're at any crowded indoor or outdoor events. This is particularly true as we head into the colder months. We still have a lot of Delta circulating, and now that we have the potential of a variant that may evade some of the protections our vaccines offer, that mask is really adding an important layer of support for all of us. Testing remains essential. It's an important tool in quickly detecting cases and allowing us therefore to reduce spread. Anybody who's sick, was potentially exposed to COVID-19, or traveled internationally over the holidays is encouraged to get tested right away. And again, we have free testing at many community sites across the county. There's testing at almost all of our pharmacies. And for those of you who have those home testing kits that are approved by the FDA, that is another reliable way to get yourself tested. We're also recommending if you participated in gatherings or events over the holidays with large numbers of people, some of whom may be unvaccinated, you too ought to go and get tested. For anyone who does test positive, please stay isolated from others for at least 10 days from the date of your symptoms, when your symptoms started, or when you tested positive if you have no symptoms. Additionally, anyone who's a close contact, you need to quarantine and get tested. As we head into the winter holidays, we do know it makes sense for us to be more cautious. And given the emergence of a new variant of concern, taking sensible steps to limit our risk of being exposed or transmitting to others is just prudent. As we learn more about Omicron, we can certainly adjust our safety measures to reflect the emerging science. For now, the focus remains on protecting those most vulnerable by continuing to do everything we can to reduce the spread. Next slide. Looking at the most commonly circulating variants in LA County has always helped us understand our local disease patterns, and it does provide us a snapshot into what may be in store with Omicron. This slide shows the change in frequency of variants identified amongst LA County residents as a percentage of all sequences reported to the Public Health Department between January of this year through November 20th. The Delta variant, here represented in red, became the dominant variant over the summer and remains the predominant variant detected among our residents, accounting for over 99% of all cases with sequenced specimens over the past 2 months. One of our state labs does continue to sequence and report archived LA County resident specimens from earlier in the pandemic. This past week, we received a large number of records from specimens that were sequenced in late 2020. There were no new mu or lambda cases that were identified, nor, as I've noted, were there any cases of Omicron. I also have an update on what we call the Delta Plus sublineage of the Delta variants, about which we shared some information several weeks ago. There's some recently published results of a UK study that showed that this Delta Plus sublineage, which is also known as AY.4.2, may be slightly less likely to cause illness than the standard Delta strains. To date, we've only seen three of the Delta Plus variants in all of the specimens that are associated with LA County residents. Next slide. And over the course of the pandemic, we have seen a variety of different variants dominate the specimen sequence, starting with Epsilon in January, which began to fade out, as you can see here, in late February and March, as the Alpha variant became more prevalent in March and April. And then in June, you begin to see the power of the Delta variant, which skyrocketed as our dominant variant and has remained since, even with these other additional variants being identified in some very small numbers. For the week of November 20th, Delta accounted for 100% of all our specimens that were sequenced. Next slide. And now to get on with our daily numbers, we are reporting an additional 24 deaths today. All of the people who died had underlying health conditions. This does bring the total number of deaths in LA County to 27,208. We extend our heartfelt wishes of peace and healing to everyone who has lost loved ones, friends, or coworkers to this virus. We're also reporting 1,970 new cases today, bringing the total number of cases in LA County to 1,530,526. To date, nearly 9.4 million people have been tested and had test results reported in LA County. Our daily positivity rate is now 1.3%. The daily average case rate is just about 8 cases per 100,000 people. This is a small decrease from last week's case rate of 9 cases per 100,000 people. CDC is estimating the weekly case rate is 54 new cases per 100,000 residents. This still reflects continued substantial transmission in the county. And while we have seen a drop in both the daily case rate and the weekly case rate, this most likely reflects a significant decrease last week in our testing numbers, where we dropped from an average of about 150,000 daily tests to 50 to 60,000 daily tests. This is because of the Thanksgiving holiday as well as school vacations. There are 574 people that are currently hospitalized with COVID-19. This is a small decrease of about 40 people from the past week. We do have 122 open outbreak investigations, both at residential settings and non-residential settings, where there's at least one confirmed case of COVID. Next slide. This is our weekly graph that shows our trends in cases, hospitalizations, and deaths from the beginning of the pandemic all the way through now the 24th of November. These trend lines show that our countywide numbers are in fact for the week ending November 24th, have a daily case average of 804 new cases per day. Hospitalization was at 563, and we were averaging about 9 deaths. Again, I want to note that these numbers are likely to go up. While these numbers have been relatively stable over the last few weeks, we do worry both about the increases we're seeing across other parts of the country and other parts of the world. Some of this we know is due to seasonal changes. We've had a lot of travel and increases in gatherings with the holiday. And so the next 10 to 14 days are going to be critically important in terms of watching to see what the impact of all of that travel and those past gatherings may be on LA County numbers. Next slide. While our metrics do look relatively stable when we're looking at them in aggregate, when we look at the outcomes by vaccination status, we can see that aggregating cases doesn't reveal the benefit of being vaccinated and just how effective the vaccines are in preventing getting infected and staying out of the hospital. So these are the trend lines that show age-adjusted case and hospitalization rates, with outcomes in vaccinated people in our solid lines and outcomes among unvaccinated people in the dotted lines. As you can see, there are higher case rates among unvaccinated people when compared to vaccinated people. Those are the green lines. Unvaccinated people are 5 times more likely to test positive for COVID than unvaccinated people. Than vaccinated people, sorry about that. We also continue to see a larger number of unvaccinated people hospitalized than vaccinated people. And unvaccinated people have 19 times the risk of hospitalization when compared to vaccinated people. This remains a very significant difference. Next slide. You know, we know at this point that the case and hospitalization risk are also determined not just by vaccination status, but there's also our age has some bearing on our risk. So this is a slide that shows our 30-day cumulative case rates in green and hospitalization rates in orange among residents in LA County aged 12 to 17. That's the first group. 18 to 49, those are the middle bars, and 50 and over, the bars over to my right. Rates among vaccinated residents are shown in those solid bars, and the rates among unvaccinated residents are shown in the crosshair bars. As you can see, the case and hospitalization rates over this period and for, you know, really since we've been tracking this remain higher for unvaccinated residents in every age group compared to those who have been vaccinated. The highest case rates continue to be among unvaccinated teens who are nearly 8 times more likely than vaccinated teens to be testing positive for COVID. And again, as you can see here, unvaccinated teens continue to have the highest case rates of any age group. Hospitalization rates were highest among residents 50 and over, and unvaccinated members in this age group are more than 15 times more likely to be hospitalized than those who had been vaccinated. Unvaccinated adults aged 18 to 49 had a 20-fold higher risk of hospitalization than those in this age group who were vaccinated. Our next slide shows the county's age-adjusted death rates. The dotted lines, again, represent outcomes in unvaccinated people. The solid line at the very bottom, it's super hard to see, represent the outcomes in vaccinated people. As you can see, for vaccinated people, there's almost been no change, and the numbers are super, super low. While among unvaccinated individuals, unfortunately, we're once again seeing an increase in deaths. The death rate among vaccinated people is 0.25 per 100,000 people. The deaths among unvaccinated people, we're seeing more than 6 deaths per 100,000 people. That means that the risk of death among unvaccinated people is 24 times higher. Next slide. We also can look at death rates by age groups. And once again, the risk of death is so much higher in unvaccinated people. And again, no deaths, fortunately, for our teens. But then once again, we start seeing, you know, these significant differences by vaccination status and deaths for both those 18 to 49 and those 50 and older. For people unvaccinated over the age of 50, you have nearly 19 times higher rate of dying when compared to people who are vaccinated. Next slide. You know, of course, we follow outcomes amongst everyone who is fully vaccinated so that we could see what the scale is of the vaccine protections. And this is even against whatever variants of concern are circulating. As usual, the numbers of cases, hospitalizations, and deaths among fully vaccinated people are visualized to scale in this model. The large green box represents the 6.1 million residents that are now fully vaccinated. The tiny purple box in the left lower corner of the green box represents the more than 80,000 fully vaccinated people, 80,000, who tested positive for COVID as of November 27th. And while every week we've seen small increases in these numbers, in all, only 1.3% of fully vaccinated people in LA County have tested positive. Of those who did test positive, about 2,600 people have been hospitalized, and that translates to 0.04% of fully vaccinated people ending up hospitalized. And there have been about 503 deaths in this group, which translates to 0.008% of fully vaccinated people tragically passing away. Hospitalization and death rates are remaining relatively stable. Next slide. With vaccines now available to everyone ages 5 and up in our county and nationwide, we continue to make progress in vaccination coverage. As of November 28th, 87% of LA County residents 65 and over received at least one dose. After about a month of vaccine eligibility, 14% of children 5 to 11 received their first dose of the vaccine. 78% of teens 12 to 17 received at least one dose. And when we look at all residents 12 and over, 74% are fully vaccinated. If you look at all LA County residents 5 and over, 76% have one dose and 64% are fully vaccinated. So far, more than 1.3 million additional or booster doses have been administered in LA County. It's important to note that booster doses across the county and the state are available to anyone who received their second dose of Pfizer or Moderna vaccine at least 6 months ago, and to anyone who received a Johnson & Johnson vaccine at least 2 months ago. This really means that about 4.5 million residents are currently eligible to receive boosters. Since it's now clear that vaccine effectiveness wanes over time, getting boosted when it's your time becomes more and more important as we prepare for the winter and the potential circulation of Omicron. Next slide. As always, it's important to continue to highlight these persistent differences in vaccination coverage between racial and ethnic age subgroups. And so we show this slide every couple of weeks. The numbers to the right of the second column show vaccination levels in people 12 and over. The subgroups with vaccination levels below 60% are noted by numbers shown in red, while the remainder of our numbers are in white. And we're glad there are lots of numbers in red, but we continue to be troubled by the fact that vaccination coverage, as you can see, remains lower among Black residents under 50 and younger Latinx adults. If we look at the first column, which is the numbers for children aged 5 to 11, and those are shown in bright blue, you see a similar troubling pattern. To date, around a third as many Black and Latinx children have been vaccinated compared with children in other racial and ethnic groups. So we're going to continue to work with our partners and community health workers to make sure that parents in these communities have good information, are getting their questions answered, and they know where to go to get their children vaccinated. Next slide. The gaps we're seeing between racial and ethnic groups do overlap with the gaps that we're also seeing by zip codes. About 60% or 550,000 of the county's 5 to 11 year olds live in what we call our high need areas that have the fewest health supporting resources. As this table shows, we've had about 45,000 children or 8% of children 5 to 11 in these higher need communities getting vaccinated. Meanwhile, we have about 81,000 children 5 to 11, which is more than 23% of the 350,000 children that live in the better resource communities already vaccinated. So, you know, we have a commitment to closing these gaps. We do need everyone's support in making sure that people are getting their questions answered. We particularly appeal to the medical community, pediatricians, family medicine providers. Please talk with your patients and your families so that they can have good information and get their questions answered. We also, of course, reach out with our mobile vaccination units, and in collaboration with those trusted partners, we're making sure that there's simple and easy access to the vaccines. Next slide. You know, unfortunately, we also have a gap in the people who are receiving additional or booster doses by zip code. This table shows that for those that live in the higher resource, more affluent communities, they have been quicker to get their booster doses than those who live in higher need communities. And while some of this difference is likely to reflect the differences in when residents in these communities receive their initial series, we do need to do a lot more work to make sure that there aren't any barriers to accessing these important additional doses, particularly now that we know what a difference the boosters can make. Next slide. I do wanna just reassure everyone that, you know, we pay a lot of attention to access because that's our primary strategy for making sure that people can get vaccinated. In order to do that, we have hundreds and hundreds of sites that are all across this county. This map shows those sites that are able to vaccinate children 5 to 11. They also can vaccinate, obviously, lots of other folks. And as you can see here, again, there are hundreds, I think over 600 sites that are available this week with those pediatric doses. Within the next few weeks, we have plans to add lots of additional sites. We think we're going to get to about 1,400 total pediatric sites by the beginning of the new year. These will be added at pharmacy schools and at private clinics. So again, working very hard to make sure there's lots of coverage, thanking all of our providers that are doing this, and please go to our map if you're looking for a place to take a child who needs their vaccinations. The next slide also shows you that, you know, we have about, almost 1,400 fixed sites across the county where everyone can go, fixed and booster sites where everyone can go to get their doses. This is a huge number. You can see it's spread fairly well over the entire county. Almost all of these sites are offering first, second, or additional booster doses. 54% of these sites are located in what we call our higher need communities. And of course, we use our mobile units to fill in the gaps and bring vaccines to community gatherings and events where there are fewer fixed sites. Next slide. We track every week how well we're doing on increasing the number of people getting those vaccines and those important booster doses. So here, first doses administered each week are in blue. Second doses are in yellow, and additional or booster doses are in orange. You can see for a few weeks, we saw a big increase in first doses, driven largely by vaccinations in children between the ages of 5 to 11. This past week with the holiday, many of our sites were closed for 1 to 2 days, so vaccination volume dropped. We are anticipating it will pick right back up. But last week, we did administer about 50,000 first doses. 20,000 of those were in children 5 to 11. There were 32,000 second doses and 137,000 additional or booster doses. So again, winter holidays are coming up. These vaccinations and boosters are going to offer everyone a critical layer of protection that we hope will help us do our very best to avoid a winter surge. Next slide. In this uncertain time, where I know a lot of us are worried about a possible winter surge and how that Omicron variant is going to affect our recovery, I do want to note that I feel some relief knowing how much we've learned about slowing the spread of COVID. And here in LA County, our schools and our skilled nursing facilities provide us with evidence of how a constellation of efforts really makes a huge difference. The very essential activities that take place at schools and in nursing homes present enormous challenges to containing an infectious virus. Yet spread in both of these sectors has been dramatically reduced through multi-pronged interventions that included vaccinations, strict adherence to masking, routine testing, and 100% follow-up with cases and close contacts. There's no need to limit implementation of these interconnected interventions to just schools and nursing homes. I think we can take these same action steps at our workplaces, houses of worship, businesses, and even within our own social networks to significantly reduce spread. Given the power of vaccine, this confluence of strategies is most effective when there are these high rates of vaccination, which include boosters for those who are eligible. And testing remains a critical linchpin, since we now can detect those infected within a few minutes. And routine testing in places where there's significant risk for transmission, we've seen has made a big difference during times where we've had high or substantial community transmission. This ability to also make sure that those who are positive remain isolated from others and that all their close contacts are notified so they can get tested, monitor themselves for symptoms, and quarantine as appropriate is also one of the best ways to stop this endless chain of transmission. These examples give me hope. I hope they give you hope that even with the possibility ahead of additional challenges with the colder weather and a new variant of concern, working together, we can use the knowledge we've gained and the tools that are at hand to protect each other and reduce the devastating impacts of COVID. Thanks, and now I'll take your questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Frere. We will now do the Q&A portion. Again, as a reminder, if you have a question for Dr. Frere, please use the hand icon or you can chat me, the host. Our first question comes from Joy Benedict from CBS2. Joy, go ahead.
Hi, Dr. Frere. Thank you so much for taking my question. I have a couple things. First, you mentioned rapid tests at the airport for international travelers starting tomorrow. Is that voluntary or mandatory for everyone landing? And if it's mandatory, how many people are you expecting to test every day out there? And then the second question, of course, earlier today, President Biden says that those take-home tests now must be covered by insurance companies. And for those who don't have insurance, they're going to start spreading them through local clinics. Do we have any idea how many of those take-home tests LA County is going to be getting for those who don't have insurance?
Yeah, I'm so glad you're asking questions about testing, because I actually think we could do a better job on testing, you know, across our country. When you look at some other countries, that they've been offering many more options for testing for a much longer period of time. So I'm so happy with the president's announcements today, because I think they are going to make a big difference. You know, for those of us who have resources, it's pretty easy. Go to the drugstore, order online. You can get those rapid test kits. And I know I use them a lot. And I know other people are using them a lot. But for people who don't have that kind of money, and they're expensive, you know, on average, they're $10 to $12 a test. So for people who don't have those resources, it's going to be super important that insurance covers it, and that for people who are uninsured or underinsured, that we make sure that there's easy access. And again, using federally qualified health centers as a distribution point for that, and our, you know, obviously our health clinics that serve people who are, you know, oftentimes uninsured, that too will make a big difference. So I applaud the president for this. I applaud him asking all the health insurance plans to step up and cover this for their members. Because again, I think testing, you know, it lets you know, right, you know, pretty much right away now, if you're in fact safe to go ahead with the activities that you're planning, whether that's going to work or going to an event or getting together and gathering with other people. It creates a lot of safety for you, and it also creates safety for the rest of us. So I'm really pleased with that. I don't have any idea about how many kits we'll actually get here in LA County. I do want to say I heard a number of 50 million will get distributed. So hopefully we get a significant number of those here in LA County, you know, that can be used across those clinics that are serving people who are uninsured or underinsured. I do want to note that the testing at the airport for international travelers, it is voluntary. That is, the federal government is highly recommending that people in fact get tested. We will have our health workers out there as well, talking to people, making sure they understand the importance of testing. And again, we're using a rapid antigen test there, so people will be able to get their results before they leave the airport. I think that provides security to them as well, that they know that they can go ahead and gather with the people they were planning to gather with, go to their final destination with some safety. I also want to note that for anybody who does come forward and gets tested and they're negative, we will send home with them a test kit so they can test themselves again 3 to 5 days later. Again, you know, we want there to be a lot of testing, and not just for international travelers, but I think just as importantly for residents and workers here in the county. Thanks for that. We can take the next question.
Thank you. Our next question comes from Ron Lin from the LA Times. Ron, go ahead.
Hey, Dr. Ferrer, thanks so much for taking our questions. Really appreciate it. Today we have questions on your advice for on the holidays, more on testing, and then finally on how the pandemic has affected HIV prevention efforts. First, do you think anyone should change travel plans for Christmas and New Year's? And would you suggest any changes in plans for holiday parties or even canceling them? Second, I think I heard you suggest that people should get tested if they participated in gatherings or events of where there are large numbers of people, some of whom may be unvaccinated. In general, does this mean that vaccinated people should get tested even in the absence of symptoms? And in general, should people in general be getting tested even if they have the sniffles? And in general, can you offer like advice on when people should test themselves? And then finally, there was a new CDC report from this week that found that between 2010 and 2019, new HIV infections among Black men having sex with men and Latino men having sex with men did not decrease between this period compared to white men who have sex with men. The CDC also said that inequities have exacerbated this disparity despite HIV prevention efforts. So the question is, how has the pandemic affected or impacted LA County's HIV prevention efforts? And how do you see the county responding in the months ahead to curb HIV infection rates? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Ron, for those questions. So maybe I'll take it from the top about holidays and, you know, what are our recommendations at this point. So I'm going to go back to what we've been recommending first all along, which is if you're unvaccinated, you really shouldn't be traveling until you're fully vaccinated. If you're fully vaccinated, but you're in a very high risk group, you're immunocompromised, you're much older, or you have some significant underlying health conditions, we want to make sure that A, you're boosted if it's appropriate for you to boost, if that time has come, and B, you may want to check in with your provider about you know, whether or not you should be delaying those travel plans until we find out more information about the threats that a new variant of concern, Omicron, might pose. I think for other people, you know, it's back to what we've asked, you know, folks to take into account, sort of the risks and the benefits. You know, clearly traveling, in, you know, allows you to have more exposures. And again, when we have sort of at this point, really not a lot of information about a potential new threat, you may decide to just delay those plans until we do have more information and we can feel pretty secure that we have the prevention strategies at hand and we're using them to protect each other from transmission of a new variant of concern. So, you know, again, I think there's a very high risk group that needs to pay particular attention and be very, very careful. In that group are people who are unvaccinated still or not fully vaccinated, as well as people at much higher risk of severe illness. And then I think for the rest of our residents and our workers, you really need to do that assessment. If you are going to travel, you know, do it with a lot of caution and a lot of care. Make sure you're using, you know, either a good KN95 mask or you're double masking, you're being particularly careful about doing a lot of hand washing, keeping your distance wherever possible, avoiding those crowds wherever you can, because that will work no matter what. No matter what's circulating, that will work to provide you with some protections. And in terms of gatherings, you know, it's the same thing. I mean, this is the time to continue to stay outdoors as much as possible for those gatherings, particularly those larger gatherings. This is the time, if you're a higher risk person, to be particularly careful about what you choose to do and where you choose to go. We'll have a lot more information on Omicron in, I would say, 10 days. So it's not a long wait for people to, you know, be able to use the additional information to make a better judgment call on what would be an appropriate activity or not such a great activity. I will say that given the evidence to date that these vaccines have been very effective against all of the variants we've seen, the one step I would urge everybody to take is get vaccinated if you're not vaccinated, and go ahead and get that booster shot as soon as possible when it's your time to get boosted. In terms of testing, you're right. You know, we don't test as much in, you know, the United States as other countries, you know, are testing. I think that there are appropriate times for people to test, certainly, as you mentioned, symptoms. And again, you know, mild symptoms, I think it depends on, you know, who you are. You're a person with allergies, you know, and you get mild symptoms, you haven't had any real exposures, it's likely to be your allergies. But you're a person who never really gets colds, you were out and about a lot over the holidays, there were a fair amount of exposures, then you might want to be that person who does go in and get tested. You know, we don't want foolishness around testing, but we do want people to acknowledge that tests, we have a lot of capacity to test people, and it's very appropriate to use testing as another tool to prevent us from spreading infection. And yes, you know, vaccinated people, certainly vaccinated people who have a known exposure or potential exposure should be getting tested. We would recommend right now vaccinated people who did a lot of traveling, particularly international traveling, and we're doing a lot of mixing with unvaccinated people in, you know, sort of those larger settings where you don't really know if somebody ends up being infected or not. Yes, I think it's a good idea to go ahead and get tested. And again, as always, for those people at higher risk of getting ill, you know, please feel free, like when you're having a gathering at your house, you're an older person, to ask people to go ahead and test themselves before they come. We should be cautious as we can be while we're getting more information about Omicron. But I also want to note Delta, highly infectious. As I reported today, we have tens of thousands of people who have had post-vaccination infections, and we should just take all that information into account. I think there are safe ways for us to continue to enjoy all the things we love, but we should be mindful about who we're gathering with and what risks people should be taking right now. Your last question is a really good question. I think for people who are living with HIV and or AIDS, and also for, you know, people living with other chronic illnesses, I want to include in there people who are struggling with substance use disorder. We do think that the pandemic has really created increased, you know, concern around the adequacy of care. People, you know, coming in for appropriate treatments, and for people getting tested and screened for diseases as regularly as they ought to be. So I do want to note that, you know, our worry is that we're going to have to do a lot more now to rectify some of the unintended consequences of some of the practices that were in place during the pandemic, particularly those practices that had people limiting their visits with healthcare providers. You know, I'm confident here. We have an amazing team of partners across the whole county that are very focused on eradicating HIV here in LA County. So I am confident that we will be able to adopt those strategies that are most effective for us to use, knowing that we have to both make up ground, and as you noted, Ron, we have to address the continued inequities and gaps in folks who are infected and folks who are in need of treatment. So I would say we'll work really hard on this, and we're grateful for all of the partners that are going to help with that as well. Thanks for that, and we can go on to the next question.
Our next question comes from Howard Bloom from the LA Times. Howard, go ahead.
Hi, thanks for being there to take our questions. Much appreciated. And I have two questions. One is, how does Omicron change or not change the analysis of what safety measures are needed at schools and the outlook for January of stepping back from some measures such as universal masking, quarantines, and regular testing? And the second question arises a little bit from what we're hearing upcoming from the CDC and President Biden. Do you favor the testing to stay in approach when there's an exposure at school over the automatic quarantine for exposed individuals? Thank you.
Yeah, these are great questions. You know, and I'm not sure, you know, I have real definitive answers for you. I mean, you know, there's no way that we're lifting our testing requirements or testing practices and masking requirements at school. We have a masking requirement at schools. We have an indoor masking requirement for everyone. That won't get lifted if it's not safe to lift it. So I'm just going to reassure everyone that we're driven by the data on that. We've laid out the criteria that we would be using to make a decision to, you know, to actually go ahead and retract an indoor masking requirement. And the fourth condition on there is that there be no circulating variant of concern that reduces the effectiveness of our vaccines or creates, you know, increased risk for us. So again, we're going to be looking at what's going on in our communities in order to make informed decisions about what needs to be in place in our communities and at our schools. I do know that, you know, there was hope that certainly some of the routine testing that's being done, particularly among those folks who are vaccinated, as more and more people get vaccinated, that becomes less and less important. It particularly becomes less and less important when we actually see less community transmission. Again, you know, routine testing is super good to do when you have high transmission, substantial transmission, not as useful to do when you have much lower rates of transmission, particularly among vaccinated people where you're likely to get a lot of false positives then. So again, we're going to be driven by the data. One promise I can make is we're going to work really hard with the state and CDC that should it be important for us to continue testing at schools, we will make sure that schools have those supplies so that it can be done and done easily. And I want to thank all the schools that are doing it now because it has made a tremendous difference. And your last question was about whether or not we're in favor of, you know, what we call modified quarantine, which allows students to remain in school under certain conditions. And I hear you on this, you know, they've had an exposure, but they're getting tested every day, because I think that's what was being discussed was if they've had an exposure, they're a close contact. Could you keep them in a more contained environment at school, still learning with a test every day? And so essentially negative tests and asymptomatic students are allowed to remain at school for the quarantine period. And we certainly would look at the evidence on that. I think, again, as similar with Delta, we want to make sure we're looking at the evidence on how effective that strategy can be with the variant that's dominating in circulation at the time we're going to consider that. We do have a modified quarantine in effect right now at our schools, as many of you know, when there's mask on mask exposure. So fully masked case exposed, you know, had a close contact that was also fully masked for the entire period of close contact, Those students, again, if they're asymptomatic, are allowed to remain at school, again, in this modified quarantine to attend to their educational needs. They're not allowed to do their social activities, but they are allowed to attend school under the modified quarantine. So we are, but we looked at a lot of data before we made the switch to that to make sure that we weren't going to increase risks at school. So we'll again be driven by the data in order to make those decisions. Thanks for that. We'll take the next question.
Our next question comes from Jackie Poitier. Jackie, you're unmuted. Go ahead.
Hi there. I have a couple buckets of questions, so let me start. Could you just please explain how you're testing for Omicron in LA County? Is every PCR test being screened for Omicron? And then separately, if you could explain a little bit more, please, about testing at LAX and how it will work with international travelers. You know, will the tests be available to incoming international passengers or just outgoing? And then if you could tell us, why not make it mandatory? It seems like that would be more effective. Thank you.
Okay. Let me take the last one just so I don't forget it, because I didn't write it all down. At LAX, the plan is for, I would call them incoming. People who arrive at LAX from international travel, they will need to get tested. They will be offered testing, and we suggest that they get tested, and then the testing is for them. For people who are leaving LAX, that wasn't the intent here. Again, depending on the country of where you're going, the testing requirements may be different for what is needed. What we're really trying to do here is prevent people who have been traveling from coming back into our communities. They're, visiting their loved ones or going back home to their final destinations where they may be positive. We want to get them in quickly and get them tested quickly. And I hear you that wouldn't it make sense for this to be mandatory? I do want to note that, the rules around international travelers have really historically, and I think in most places this continues to be developed and determined by the federal government. And then at the local levels, we actually try hard to implement federal requirements. So if the federal government were to require testing for all incoming international travelers, we would be supporting that and working with the federal government to make sure that it was at that point explained as a mandatory requirement. It's really just a recommendation right now. We'll do our best to provide good information to those incoming travelers, international travelers, so that they will feel how important it is for them to go ahead and take advantage of this offer. But at this moment in time, it is just a recommendation, not a requirement. In terms of, which positive samples get sequenced, it's a great question. It's not every sample. You look at it, you see our numbers every day. So let's just assume on average, here in LA County, we have about 7,000 plus people who test positive every week. We sample and sequence of those positive cases somewhere between 20 and 25% of those right now for everything. They're just sequenced so we can figure out what strain of the virus is circulating. We do always have some priority groups where their tests are, where their positive tests are in fact often sequenced. Whenever we have outbreaks, we try to figure out what's going on in the outbreak situation. Certainly now we're going to be working really hard if we have international travelers that are testing positive to make sure that those samples get sequenced. It's been a lot around sort of clusters that seem unusual or outbreaks where we're really trying to figure out what's going on. And then it's just also there's some randomness to this, which we would want as well. In other words, we want there to be some way to be sampling fairly randomly across samples from people who live in different places in the county so that we have a good idea. But I do want to note that We are one of the counties with some of the highest rates in terms of percents of our positive cases that do get sequenced. And that, again, is a huge partnership with commercial labs as well as the public health labs. So thanks for that. Next question. This will probably have to, if there's any more questions, this will need to be our last.
Okay, I do have a follow-up from Ron Lynn.
Okay.
Ron, you wanna go ahead and ask your follow-up?
Yeah, just will the newly announced coronavirus tests at LAX for incoming travelers be free?
Yes, they are free. And I wanna thank the state because this is a partnership with the state who is making sure we have test kits to do this.
Okay, great. That concludes our briefing. Any closing remarks, Dr. Ferrer?
No, just thanks, everyone. I know there's a lot going on. You know, always feel free to reach out to us if you have questions or we can be helpful in any way. We appreciate everything you're doing to keep the public well informed. So thanks a million.
Thank you. As a reminder, if you have any additional questions, you can send us those questions and others at the media inbox, which is media@ph.lacounty.gov. Our Spanish remarks will be coming up in just a few minutes. Hi, Monica, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Excellent. Okay, I can see you. Right. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us for the Scottish portion of today's briefing. Today is Thursday, December 2nd. We have Monica here with us today. Monica, when you are ready.
Okay, I'm ready. So, gracias por acompañarnos en la sesión informativa de hoy. Esta tarde presentamos información sobre Omicron y presentaremos nuestras métricas por estado de vacunación y grupos de edad y nuestro progreso en la vacunación de nuestros residentes. Terminaremos con algunas reflexiones sobre cómo podemos usar las lecciones que hemos aprendido de las escuelas sobre cómo mitigar la propagación para este invierno. First slide, please. Durante la pandemia, siempre hemos sabido que habría más mutaciones, lo que daría como resultado la posibilidad de una variante más peligrosa que la variante Delta, y estamos preparados para responder a medida que surge más información científica. En el transcurso de la última semana hemos estado rastreando la aparición y propagación de Omicron, etiquetada como una variante de preocupación tanto por la Organización Mundial de la Salud como por los CDC. Ayer se anunció el primer caso en Estados Unidos en un viajero que regresaba de Sudáfrica. Esta mañana se identificó un segundo caso en el país en una persona en Minnesota que recientemente viajó a Nueva York y uno tercero en Colorado. Esta nueva variante B.1.1.529 se identificó por primera vez en Sudáfrica el 9 de noviembre y tiene un alto número de mutaciones, lo que genera preocupaciones con respecto a la evasión inmunológica y su capacidad de propagación. Esta nueva variante fue designada como una variante de preocupación por la Organización Mundial de la Salud el pasado viernes 26 de noviembre y la llamó Omicron. El 30 de noviembre, los CDC también declararon a Omicron como una variante de preocupación. Lo que hace que Omicron sea preocupante es que tiene una constelación de mutaciones muy inusual. Los primeros análisis que hay muestran 50 cambios y supresiones, más de 30 de los cuales están en el gen de la espiga. El perfil de mutación es claramente muy diferente al de otras variantes de preocupación y variantes de interés que circulan y no parece derivarse de Delta u otras variantes de interés. Cabe señalar que algunas de las mutaciones en el gen de la espiga podrían afectar la estructura lo suficiente como para aumentar la inefectividad, evadir la inmunidad y causar impacto en la respuesta a los anticuerpos monoclonales. Los primeros signos de los laboratorios de diagnóstico indican que Omicron se propaga rápidamente, ya que ahora es la cepa dominante en Sudáfrica y es probable que esté presente en la mayoría de las provincias de Sudáfrica. A hoy, Omicron ya está presente en 35 países, con dos casos detectados en Estados Unidos, uno en el condado de San Francisco, otro en Minnesota y uno más en Colorado. Tres casos detectados. No hay casos en el condado de Los Ángeles. Queremos enfatizar que si bien todavía estamos aprendiendo sobre la capacidad de contagio y gravedad de los casos, el riesgo de infección y la efectividad de la vacuna, hay pasos que estamos tomando para preparar a nuestro condado, comenzando por brindar información actualizada sobre Omicron y las medidas de seguridad preventiva a los residentes y nuestros aliados. A principios de esta semana, los proveedores de atención médica del condado de Los Ángeles recibieron información del Departamento de Salud Pública que detallaba datos sobre la evaluación de riesgos y las instrucciones para enviar muestras para secuenciar. Los residentes también pueden visitar nuestro sitio de internet para obtener actualizaciones diarias sobre Omicron al hacer clic en el aviso de nuestra página de internet. Nuestro laboratorio también está coordinando con el Laboratorio Estatal para la Identificación de Omicron con pruebas a muestras. Actualmente, cada semana se secuencian entre 1,500 y 5,000 muestras positivas de residentes del Condado de Los Ángeles y los resultados se informan tanto al Condado de Los Ángeles como al Estado. Continuaremos confiando en esta red de laboratorios comerciales y de salud pública para asegurarnos de que estamos recibiendo una evaluación representativa de las variantes prevalentes en el condado de Los Ángeles y continuaremos compartiendo esta información con el público. De nuevo, a la fecha, el laboratorio del condado no ha identificado alguna presencia de Omicron en las muestras secuenciadas de los residentes del condado de Los Ángeles. Con 1,7 millones de estudiantes y personal de regreso a las escuelas esta semana, después del receso de Acción de Gracias, también estamos trabajando con todos los distritos escolares para reforzar la importancia de los requisitos de salud pública existentes en las escuelas y los programas de pruebas rutinarias. También contamos con equipos que realinean los planes para proteger a los más vulnerables, incluidos los que viven y trabajan en centros de enfermería especializada, cárceles y refugios. Esto incluye asegurar el suministro adecuado de equipos de prueba y equipo de protección personal, junto con la modificación de las políticas para garantizar una seguridad óptima según se justifique. A finales de esta semana, modificaremos nuestras instrucciones en los centros de enfermería especializada para exigir pruebas de rutina de los residentes y el personal y pruebas rápidas para los visitantes que ingresan a los espacios interiores de estas instalaciones. Y en asociación con el aeropuerto LAX, el Estado y los CDC, estaremos instalando un sitio de pruebas rápidas en el Terminal Internacional mañana para brindar información y ofrecer pruebas rápidas a los viajeros internacionales. Enviaremos un mensaje sobre la necesidad de que los viajeros internacionales cumplan con la guía federal de cuarentena y pruebas. Todos los viajeros que den positivo deberán aislarse y sus contactos cercanos deberán ponerse en cuarentena. Next slide, please. Con el surgimiento de una variante más infecciosa, nos preocupa a nosotros, como a muchos de ustedes, la seguridad de nuestros compañeros de trabajo y lo que esto podría significar para nuestro trayecto hacia la recuperación. Y aunque no podemos saber con certeza el impacto de Omicron, nos alienta el hecho de que tenemos mucha experiencia para desacelerar la propagación de COVID, junto con herramientas efectivas que sabemos que funcionan para reducir el contagio. La herramienta más eficaz siguen siendo las vacunas y alentamos a todas las personas de 5 años o más que aún no estén vacunadas y no hayan recibido su dosis de refuerzo, a que lo hagan con un sentido de urgencia. Las vacunas que se desarrollaron hace más de un año han demostrado ser eficaces contra la variante Delta y cepas anteriores del virus. Esto nos da la esperanza razonable de que estas mismas vacunas pueden también proporcionar alguna protección contra Omicron. Como recordatorio, los residentes pueden ingresar a cualquier sitio de vacunación de salud pública o hacer una cita en los cientos de sitios en todo el condado para vacunarse. Para obtener más información, puede visitar la página de internet vacunateLosAngeles.com. Mientras los equipos están trabajando para determinar qué tan efectivas son las vacunas contra Omicron, todos los residentes del condado de Los Ángeles deben seguir cumpliendo con los requisitos de uso de mascarilla y siempre usar el cubrebocas cuando estén en el interior o en megaeventos al aire libre, independiente del estado de vacunación. Recomendamos que las personas usen la mascarilla cuando estén en el interior o al aire libre de eventos llenos de gente. La prueba también es esencial, ya que es una herramienta importante para detectar casos rápidamente y permitirnos reducir la propagación. Se alienta a cualquier residente que esté enfermo, haya estado potencialmente expuesto al COVID-19 o haya viajado fuera del país durante las vacaciones a hacerse la prueba. Y si participó en reuniones y eventos con un gran número de personas, algunas de las cuales puede que no hayan estado vacunadas, también le recomendamos que se haga la prueba. Cualquiera que dé positivo en la prueba debe quedarse en casa durante al menos 10 días después de que comenzaron sus síntomas y no tiene fiebre durante al menos 24 horas y sus síntomas mejoran. Además, cualquier persona que se determine que tiene un contacto cercano también puede ponerse en cuarentena y/o hacerse la prueba. A medida que nos acercamos a las festividades de invierno, sabemos que tiene sentido que seamos más cautelosos y dado el surgimiento de una nueva variante de preocupación, es prudente tomar medidas sensatas para limitar nuestro riesgo de exposición o contagio. A medida que aprendamos más sobre Omicron, ciertamente podemos ajustar nuestras medidas de seguridad para que reflejen la información científica que surja. Por ahora, el enfoque sigue siendo proteger a los más vulnerables al continuar haciendo todo lo posible por reducir la propagación. Next slide, please. Observar las variantes más comunes que están circulando en el condado de Los Ángeles nos ayuda a comprender nuestros patrones de enfermedades a nivel local y proporciona una idea instantánea de lo que puede suceder con Omicron. Esta diapositiva muestra el cambio en la frecuencia de las variantes identificadas entre los residentes del condado de Los Ángeles como un porcentaje de todas las secuencias informadas a salud pública entre enero de este año y el 20 de noviembre. La variante Delta, aquí representada en rojo, se convirtió en la variante dominante durante el verano y sigue siendo la variante predominante detectada en nuestros residentes, representando más del 99% de todos los casos con muestras secuenciadas durante los últimos 2 meses. Uno de nuestros laboratorios estatales continúa secuenciando e informando muestras archivadas, tomadas de los residentes del condado de Los Ángeles durante la pandemia. La semana pasada recibimos una gran cantidad de registros de especímenes secuenciados a fines del 2020. No hubo entre ellos nuevos casos de Mu, Lambda o de Omicron. También tenemos una actualización sobre el sublinaje Delta Plus, de variantes Delta, sobre el cual compartimos información hace varias semanas. Los resultados recientemente publicados de un estudio en el Reino Unido han demostrado que el sublinaje Delta Plus, también conocido como AWY.4.2, pueda que tenga menos probabilidades de causar enfermedad que la cepa Delta estándar. Hasta la fecha, hemos visto solo 3 de las variantes Delta Plus en especímenes asociados de residentes del condado de Los Ángeles. Next slide, please. En el transcurso de la pandemia hemos visto una diversidad de variantes diferentes que dominan los especímenes secuenciados, comenzando por Epsilon en enero, que comenzó a desvanecerse a fines de febrero y marzo, ya que la variante alfa se volvió más frecuente en marzo y abril. En junio comenzamos a ver el poder de la variante Delta, que se disparó como nuestra variante dominante y se ha mantenido desde entonces, incluso con otras variantes adicionales identificadas en pequeñas cantidades. Para la semana del 20 de noviembre, Delta representó el 100% de todas nuestras muestras secuenciadas. Next slide, please. Nos entristece informar hoy de 24 muertes más. Todas las personas que murieron tenían problemas de salud subyacentes. Esto eleva el número total de muertes a 27,208 en el condado de Los Ángeles. Extendemos nuestras oraciones por el alivio y el consuelo a todos los que han perdido a sus seres queridos, amigos, compañeros de trabajo a causa de este virus. Hoy estamos informando 1,970 casos nuevos, lo que eleva el número total de casos en el condado de Los Ángeles a 1,530,526. Hasta la fecha, casi 9,4 millones de personas han sido evaluadas y se han reportado en los resultados de las pruebas en el condado de Los Ángeles. La tasa de casos positivos con base en la prueba diaria es de 1,3%. Nuestra tasa de casos promedio diaria es ahora de casi 8 casos por 100,000 personas, un pequeño aumento con respecto a la tasa de casos con retraso de 3 días de la semana pasada de 9 casos por 100,000. La estimación de los CDC de nuestra tasa de casos semanales es ahora de 54 casos nuevos por cada 100,000 residentes, lo que refleja una propagación sustancial que continúa en todo el condado. La caída en las tasas es probablemente un reflejo de la disminución significativa la semana pasada en nuestros números de pruebas, que cayeron un promedio de 150,000 pruebas diarias a 50,000 o 60,000 pruebas diarias con las vacaciones de Acción de Gracias y de las escuelas. Hay 574 personas hospitalizadas actualmente con COVID-19, disminución de 42 personas durante la semana pasada. Actualmente, 122 investigaciones abiertas en entornos residenciales, colectivos y entornos no residenciales con al menos un caso confirmado de COVID-19. Next slide, please. Este gráfico muestra tendencias en casos, hospitalizaciones y muertes en nuestro condado desde el comienzo de la pandemia al 24 de noviembre de este año. Estas líneas de tendencia muestran nuestros números en todo el condado sin diferenciar a las personas por estado de vacunación. Para la semana que finalizó el 24 de noviembre, el promedio de casos de 7 días fue de 804 casos nuevos por día. El promedio de hospitalización fue de 563 y con un promedio de 9 muertes por día. Si bien estas cifras han estado relativamente estables durante las últimas semanas, estamos viendo aumentos en todo el país y en otras partes del mundo que probablemente se deban a cambios estacionales y aumentos en las reuniones entre personas. Aquí en el condado de Los Ángeles hemos estado atentos a detectar cambios después de las celebraciones del Día de Acción de Gracias que probablemente se producirán dentro de 10 a 14 días. Next slide, please. Si bien nuestras métricas parecen relativamente estables cuando las miramos en conjunto, cuando observamos estos resultados por estado de vacunación, vemos que al agregar casos no se refleja el beneficio de estar vacunado y de cuán efectivas son las vacunas para prevenir la infección y evitar una hospitalización. Estas líneas de tendencia muestran las tasas de casos de hospitalización ajustadas por edad con los resultados en las personas vacunadas en líneas continuas y los resultados en las personas no vacunadas en líneas punteadas. Continuamos viendo tasas de casos más altas entre las personas no vacunadas, mientras que las tasas entre las personas vacunadas permanecen estables y bajas. Y las personas no vacunadas tienen 5 veces más probabilidades de dar positivo en la prueba de COVID que las personas no vacunadas. También seguimos viendo un mayor número de personas no vacunadas en los hospitales que de personas vacunadas, ya que las personas no vacunadas ahora tienen 19 veces más riesgo de hospitalización que las personas vacunadas, una diferencia significativa. Next slide, please. El riesgo de casos de hospitalización se determina tanto por el estado de vacunación como por la edad. Esta diapositiva muestra en verde las tasas de casos acumuladas a 30 días y en naranja las tasas de hospitalización entre los residentes del condado de Los Ángeles de 12 a 17, 18 a 49 y 50 años o más. Las tasas entre los residentes vacunados se muestran en barras sólidas, mientras que las tasas entre los residentes no vacunados se muestran en barras cruzadas. Como puede ver, las tasas de casos y hospitalización durante este periodo fueron más altas para los residentes no vacunados en comparación con los que habían sido vacunados. Las tasas de casos más altas continúan observándose entre los adolescentes no vacunados, que tenían casi 8 veces más probabilidades que los adolescentes vacunados de dar positivo en la prueba de COVID y que continúan teniendo las tasas de casos más altas de cualquier grupo de edad. Las tasas de hospitalización fueron más altas entre los residentes de 50 años o más, y los miembros no vacunados de este grupo de edad tenían más de 15 veces de probabilidades de ser hospitalizados que los que habían sido vacunados. Mientras tanto, los adultos no vacunados de entre 18 y 49 años tenían un riesgo 20 veces mayor de hospitalización que aquellos en este grupo de edad que fueron vacunados. Next slide, please. Esta diapositiva muestra las tasas de muerte ajustadas por edad en el condado de Los Ángeles con líneas de puntos que representan nuevamente los resultados en personas no vacunadas y líneas continuas que representan los resultados en personas vacunadas. No ha habido muchos cambios en las tasas de mortalidad de las personas vacunadas, mientras que entre las personas no vacunadas, una vez más, estamos viendo un aumento. Si bien la tasa de mortalidad entre las personas vacunadas es de 0,25 por cada 100,000 personas, las muertes entre las personas no vacunadas fueron de más de 6 muertes por cada 100,000 personas en la semana del 13 de noviembre, lo que significa que el riesgo de muerte fue casi 24 veces mayor entre las personas no vacunadas que entre las que habían muerto y habían sido vacunadas. Next slide, please. Al observar las tasas de muerte entre grupos de edad, podemos ver que el riesgo de muerte es mayor en las personas no vacunadas de 18 a 49 años y significativamente mayor en las personas no vacunadas mayores de 50 años, ya que la tasa de mortalidad de las personas no vacunadas mayores de 50 años es casi 19 veces más alto que las personas vacunadas en este mismo grupo de edad, lo que muestra cuán efectivas son las vacunas para prevenir la muerte. Next slide, please. Seguir los resultados entre las personas completamente vacunadas nos permite ver la escala completa de las protecciones de las vacunas, incluso contra las variantes de preocupación que presentamos anteriormente. Como es habitual, el número de casos, hospitalizaciones y muertes entre personas completamente vacunadas se visualiza a escala. El recuadro verde grande representa a los 6,1 millones de residentes que ahora están completamente vacunados. El pequeño recuadro violeta en la esquina inferior izquierda de este recuadro verde representa a las más de 80,000 personas completamente vacunadas que dieron positivo por COVID al 27 de noviembre. Y aunque cada semana hay pequeños aumentos en estos números, en total, solo el 1,3% de las personas completamente vacunadas en el condado de Los Ángeles han dado positivo. De los que dieron positivo, alrededor de 2,600 personas fueron hospitalizadas, lo que se traduce en un 0,044% de todas las personas completamente vacunadas que resultaron en el hospital. Ha habido 503 muertes en este grupo, lo que se traduce en el fallecimiento del 0,008% de las personas totalmente vacunadas. Las tasas de hospitalización y muerte se mantienen relativamente estables. Next slide, please. Con las vacunas ahora disponibles para todas las personas de 5 años o más en nuestro condado y en todo el país, continuamos progresando en la cobertura de vacunación en todo el condado. Al 28 de noviembre, el 87% de los residentes del condado de Los Ángeles de 65 años o más habían recibido al menos una dosis de la vacuna. Después de aproximadamente un mes de que se aprobara la vacuna para los menores, el 14% de los niños de 5 a 11 años han recibido una dosis de la vacuna. El 78% de los adolescentes de 12 a 17 años han recibido al menos una dosis. Y cuando observamos a todos los residentes de 12 años o más, el 83% ha recibido una dosis y el 74% está completamente vacunado. haciendo un acercamiento aún más para observar a todos los residentes del condado de Los Ángeles de 5 años o más, el 76% ha recibido al menos una dosis, mientras que el 64% está completamente vacunado. Hasta ahora, se han administrado más de 1,3 millones de dosis adicionales o de refuerzo en el condado de Los Ángeles. Es importante destacar que las dosis de refuerzo en todo el condado y el estado están disponibles actualmente para cualquier persona que haya recibido sus segundas dosis de las vacunas Pfizer o Moderna hace al menos 6 meses y para quienes recibieron una vacuna Johnson & Johnson hace al menos 2 meses. Eso significa que más de 4,5 millones de residentes son actualmente, pueden actualmente recibir los refuerzos. Dado que la efectividad de la vacuna disminuye con el tiempo, recibir un refuerzo cuando llega el momento se vuelve cada vez más importante a medida que nos preparamos para el invierno y la posible circulación de Omicron. Next slide, please. Sabemos que persisten las diferencias en la cobertura de vacunación entre subgrupos de edad raciales y étnicos, como lo demuestra esta diapositiva. Si miramos los números a la derecha de la segunda columna que muestran los niveles de vacunación en personas mayores de 12 años, los subgrupos con niveles de vacunación por debajo del 60% se indican mediante números en rojo, mientras que el resto está en blanco. Como puede ver, si bien la mayoría de los grupos han logrado grandes avances en la vacunación, la cobertura de vacunación sigue siendo menor entre los residentes afroamericanos menores de 50 años y los adultos jóvenes latinos. Si miramos la primera columna, donde los números para niños de 5 a 11 años se muestran en azul brillante, puede ver el mismo patrón preocupante que hemos visto en adultos más jóvenes y adolescentes. A la fecha, alrededor de un tercio de los niños afroamericanos y latinos han sido vacunados en comparación con los niños de otros grupos raciales y étnicos. Continuamos trabajando con aliados y trabajadores de la salud comunitarios para asegurarnos de que los padres de estas comunidades tengan buena información, obtengan respuestas a sus preguntas y sepan dónde ir para vacunar a sus hijos. Next slide, please. Las brechas que estamos viendo entre los grupos raciales y étnicos se superponen con las brechas que vemos entre los códigos postales. Aproximadamente el 60% o 550,000 de los niños de 5 a 11 años de nuestro condado viven en las áreas de mayor necesidad con la menor cantidad de recursos de apoyo a la salud. Como muestra esta tabla, más de 45,000 o el 8% de los niños de 5 a 11 años están en estos códigos postales de alta necesidad y han sido vacunados. Mientras tanto, alrededor de 81,000, más del 23% de los 350,000 niños que viven en comunidades con mejores recursos han sido vacunados. Como parte de nuestro compromiso de cerrar estas brechas, nos estamos comunicando con unidades móviles de vacunación y en colaboración con aliados comunitarios confiables para asegurarnos de que sea simple y fácil para los niños y las familias de todo el condado acceder tanto a las vacunas como a la información de alta calidad. Next slide, please. Desafortunadamente, también estamos viendo una brecha en las personas que recibieron dosis adicionales o de refuerzo por códigos postales. Esta tabla muestra que aquellos que viven en comunidades más prósperas han recibido sus dosis de refuerzo más rápido que aquellos que viven en comunidades muy necesitadas. Si bien es probable que parte de la diferencia refleje las diferencias en el momento en que los residentes recibieron su serie inicial, tendremos que trabajar más para asegurarnos de que no haya barreras para acceder a estas importantes dosis adicionales. Next slide, please. Nuestra estrategia principal para garantizar el acceso es tener cientos de sitios en todas las partes del condado donde todas las personas mayores de 5 años puedan vacunarse o recibir un refuerzo. En este mapa puede ver los 601 sitios que actualmente administran las vacunas pediátricas de Pfizer a niños de 5 a 11 años, que incluyen centros de salud del condado y de la ciudad y puestos de vacunación, centros de distribución de vacunas, farmacias, clínicas comunitarias y privadas, centros de salud calificados a nivel federal y sitios móviles. En las próximas semanas planeamos tener más de 1,400 sitios con la vacuna pediátrica, muchos de ellos en farmacias, escuelas y clínicas privadas adicionales. Casi todos estos sitios también ofrecen vacunas a adolescentes mayores y adultos. Como puede ver, aunque el acceso es bastante bueno en todo el condado, mejorará drásticamente para fin de año para brindar un mejor acceso a una pequeña cantidad de comunidades en el condado. Next slide, please. En este mapa, donde las comunidades de alta necesidad están resaltadas en verde pálido, puede ver los 186 sitios móviles en azul y los 1,200 sitios fijos adicionales en todo el condado, donde los residentes pueden obtener la primera, la segunda y la dosis adicional o de refuerzo de todas las personas aprobadas para recibir la vacuna. Más del 54% de nuestros puestos de vacunación fijos están ubicados en comunidades de alta necesidad y nuestras unidades móviles están asignadas para llenar los vacíos al llevar vacunas a los lugares donde se reúnen las personas en aquellas comunidades donde hay menos sitios fijos. Next slide, please. En esta tabla, las primeras dosis administradas cada semana están representadas en azul, mientras que las segundas dosis están en amarillo y las dosis adicionales o de refuerzo están en naranja. Durante algunas semanas vimos un aumento en las primeras dosis, impulsado en gran parte por la vacunación en niños entre las edades de 5 a 11 años. La semana pasada, con el feriado, muchos sitios se cerraron durante uno o dos días y el volumen de vacunación disminuyó. La semana pasada administramos unas 50,000 primeras dosis, de las cuales unas 20,000 fueron primeras dosis para niños de 5 a 11 años, así como 32,000 segundas dosis y 137,000 dosis adicionales o de refuerzo. Con las próximas festividades de invierno, las vacunas y los refuerzos ofrecen una capa fundamental de protección para ayudarnos a hacer nuestro mejor esfuerzo para evitar un aumento repentino durante el invierno. Next slide, please. En este momento incierto, en el que muchos de nosotros estamos preocupados por una posible oleada invernal y cómo la variante Omicron afectará nuestra recuperación, sentimos un poco de alivio al saber cuánto hemos aprendido sobre cómo frenar la propagación del COVID. Y aquí en el condado de Los Ángeles, nuestras escuelas e instalaciones de enfermería especializada nos brindan evidencia de cómo una variedad de esfuerzos puede marcar una gran diferencia. Las actividades muy esenciales que tienen lugar en las escuelas y en los centros de enfermería especializada presentan enormes desafíos para contener un virus infeccioso. Sin embargo, la propagación se ha reducido drásticamente en esos dos entornos a través de intervenciones múltiples que han incluido vacunas, estricto cumplimiento del uso de mascarilla y pruebas de rutina y seguimiento al 100% de los casos y contactos cercanos. No es necesario limitar la implementación de estas intervenciones interconectadas solo a escuelas y hogares especializados de enfermería. Podemos tomar estas mismas acciones en lugares de trabajo, lugares para profesar la fe, negocios e incluso dentro de nuestras propias redes sociales para reducir significativamente la propagación. Dado el poder de las vacunas, esta confluencia de estrategias es más eficaz cuando hay altas tasas de vacunación, incluidos los refuerzos para los grupos aprobados. Las pruebas siguen siendo un eje fundamental, ya que ahora podemos detectar a los infectados en unos pocos minutos, y las pruebas de rutina en lugares donde existe un riesgo significativo de contagio marcan la diferencia en momentos en los que hay una propagación comunitaria, alta o sustancial. Y la capacidad de asegurarse de que aquellos que son positivos permanezcan aislados de los demás y que todos sus contactos cercanos sean notificados para que puedan hacerse la prueba, monitorearse a sí mismos en busca de síntomas y ponerse en cuarentena según corresponda, son formas muy efectivas de detener una cadena interminable de contagio. Estos ejemplos nos dan la esperanza de que incluso con la posibilidad de enfrentar desafíos adicionales con el clima más frío y una nueva variante de preocupación, trabajando juntos podemos usar el conocimiento que hemos adquirido y las herramientas disponibles. Estos pasos nos han demostrado cuán efectivas han sido nuestras escuelas e instalaciones especializadas de enfermería. Animamos a todos a que utilicen estas herramientas y nos ayuden a evitar un aumento repentino durante el invierno y Omicron. Muchas gracias y hasta la próxima.
Thank you so much, Monica, and thank you to everyone who joined us today. As a reminder, you can send any questions you may have to our media inbox at media@ph.lacounty.gov. Thank you again for joining us, and we'll see you next week.